This is the 1995 Ferrari 456 GT, and it's the last proper Ferrari Grand Tour before modern technology and modern Ferrari took over. Plus, it's a manual. What's it like? Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racer, lover of driving fast, fun things, and on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, the 456 for me was iconic. I was a little younger at the time when this was introduced, and it was an incredible car. And it did nearly 200 miles an hour, had a V12, and of course, this manual gearbox. It was something all of us aspired to if we wanted to drive a grand touring Ferrari. The occasion is now here, and I get to spend a little time with this 456. And before we get into what this Ferrari 456 GT is like to drive, let's have a look at it in a little more depth. Mechanically, this is pretty old school, and everything about this Ferrari 456 is old school, because back in the day, way before this 456, they used to make Ferraris out of tube frames. Yes, it's not a unit body kind of construction. This is actually a tube frame construction. On top of that, we've got the Pininfarina designed and manufactured body. Under the long hood is a 5.5 liter V12, makes 436 horsepower at 6,250 RPM, 406 pounds of torque at 4,500 RPM. This one is equipped right with the 6-speed manual, of course. There's a mechanical limited slip diff in the back. Steering is hydraulically assisted. Suspension's based around double wishbones at the front and the rear. Brakes are 4-piston calipers at the front with 330 millimeter rotors. Rear are 4-piston calipers as well with 310 millimeter rotors.
In a nod to the future, Ferrari equipped this with 3-mode adjustable dampers, and get this, active aerodynamics.
Wheels and tires are 17s with 255 wide at the front, 285 wide at the rear tires. Curb weight at its lightest specification is a little over 3,700 pounds. These did get heavier as production went on. And static weight distribution is 50-50, but on this channel we know it's not static weight distribution that counts, it's how you use it. You guys know I'm more of an engine roar kind of guy than an earbud kind of guy, but that is until Raycon came on the scene and turned me into a believer with their top-notch audio gear. Rev up your purchase with 15% off. Just go to the link in the description box below or direct to buyraycon.com/BrianMax and you'll get 15% off your order. This isn't just a great deal, it's a great way to help keep your favorite car channel running on all cylinders, but don't hit the brakes just yet. We've got a special surprise for you, courtesy of Raycon. Raycon's all about proving that premium sound and essential smart tech don't have to cost a supercar. And they're all about top-tier quality without any of the marketing fluff. Raycon doesn't farm out any of their design or development. No, it's all done in-house by their top-tier team of audio development engineers who cut their teeth at Bose and Peloton, and those are two brands that I have in my house. I never gave much thought to earbuds until last year when we launched our racing team. Suddenly, I'm on endless calls with the team, drivers, partners, you name it. And when I'm filming episodes in the countryside or taking my dog for a walk, my everyday earbuds from Raycon are my co-pilots. With their stellar sound quality, noise isolation, and awareness mode, they've seamlessly integrated into my daily routine. Remember, you can claim 15% off on these game changers by clicking the link in the description box or visiting buyraycon.com/BrianMax. The everyday earbuds from Raycon have turbocharged my daily life. They're so compact and convenient. I simply pocket them when I'm not using them and pop them in whenever I want. And if my phone rings, it's a breeze to take the call and keep my day in high gear. I'm particularly impressed with these custom gel tips for a perfect in-ear fit. No problem for me. Call quality is excellent, and there's 8 hours of playtime on these. To get your 15% off, go to the link in the description box below or direct to buyraycon.com/BrianMax. And since you've stuck around, here's that special surprise. Courtesy of Raycon, we're giving away this pair of everyday earbuds. You have to be a subscriber. You have to be following me on Instagram. All you need to do is drop a comment below with the hashtag Raycon Everyday Earbuds, and you're in the running.
Thank you.
There's a lot about this cockpit that is delightfully old school and a little modern. The seating position is not bad at all. It is a little bit on the old school side. Today, cars have perfect seating positions with incredible adjustments in the seats and the steering column. That's not quite the case here. It is kind of limited, but I'm actually able to find a decent seating position here. I'm very content behind the wheel. I've got a great relationship to the steering wheel if my arms are extended a little in the old school Italian style, but a great relationship to the pedals as well. Then, of course, we can easily reach this gated shifter, and this right here is worth the price of admission. Just love the gated shifter. That is just perfection. And surprisingly, there's a dead pedal here. The pedals are spaced perfectly. I did choose to wear skate shoes today, not fancy driving loafers, and we've got a great relationship to the pedals, and I can heel and toe properly. The story here inside this cabin is about its compact dimensions, and that goes for the car as well. There's not a tremendous amount of room. It feels more cozy than it does spacious. And I think you and a passenger will be very comfortable here on a long drive, even with the limited adjustment in these seats. And these seats are very Italian. They seem like they were designed first for their aesthetic before they were designed for their ergonomics. There's a limited amount of room in that back seat. I don't think I can fit behind myself in the seating position. I'm not quite sure who would go back there, and there's a little bit of room in the trunk as well. This is something where you and a companion can go on a long, long journey and have a great time. The ergonomics are definitely 90s Ferrari. They are very unique. Gotta love this Ferrari branded Sony stereo. Is that what we call this? There's no CD player. There is a CD changer in the trunk. There's certainly no cassette player here. One of the coolest things about being behind the wheel of a 1990s Ferrari is the gauge cluster is very, very simple. There's a speedometer and a tachometer, and that's all you get. There's a delightful lack of modern conveniences. Cruise control? Nope. Navigation? Nope, you're on your own. And another highlight of this 456 is you've got incredible visibility in all directions, and you don't even need a backup camera because the compact dimensions of this 456 make it very easy to park. This is just a thrill. The funny thing about this 456 is it doesn't feel like it weighs 3,700 pounds. That seems to be the figure that everybody has quoted over the years. Certainly doesn't feel like it weighs 3,700 pounds. On the other hand, this engine doesn't feel like it makes over 400 horsepower, but it is absolutely a delight to run up to redline. This car actually doesn't have a lot of mileage. There has been some work done on the engine, and it's proper. It's just a delight to drive and rev all the way up to its past 7,000 RPM redline. Back in the day, Ferrari said this would do 0 to 60 in about 5 seconds, and it would do well over 190 miles an hour. And that's pretty incredible given the dynamics of this 456, which we will discuss in a little bit. In my time with this car, it's never put a foot wrong in terms of putting down power. Now, I'm not going to abuse this thing, but I am driving it because I'm enjoying it, and we're using all of its 12 cylinders to put down power, and it never really puts a foot wrong. I'm really impressed. This is very much an analog car. It's an analog, very mechanical driving experience. Wow, this is just a blast to drive. And it's definitely rewarding to take that V12 all the way up to its power peak near its red line. This is just incredible, but the driving experience is dominated by this gated shifter. It is just a delight, and I wish we could get more of these today. It's a blast to drive, and if you haven't driven a gated shifter manual gearbox, you definitely need to experience that. Funny enough, the gearing seems spot on for this car. I'm not quite sure what I should have expected, but the gearing is absolutely spot on. I'm rarely touching sixth gear, and you can see if you're running this in sixth gear how it could really stretch its legs and get to 190 miles an hour, no trouble at all. On this channel with Modern Cars, we often talk about drive modes and adaptive cruise control and stability control and traction control. And here's the thing, the only thing that's here to help you is ABS. Traction control, that's your right foot. Stability control, that's your right foot and your two hands. That's about all you've got. This is a wonderfully simple yet sophisticated driving experience. I mean, this is a gorgeous 2+2 Ferrari Grand Tour, and you really have to pay attention to what you're doing. There are no electronics that are here to save you. A word about the steering in this 456. The fact that it is hydraulically assisted is apparent from the moment you turn the steering wheel. You can tell exactly what's going on at those two front contact patches, and that is something from a completely different era. There's nothing quite as alive as this 456 GT in terms of its steering. That said, what I'm surprised with is the slowness of the steering rack. I would have expected a quicker steering rack here in a Ferrari, but when you think about it, this was intended to be a Grand Tour, and if you were going to cross the European continent at great speed, you'd like a little bit more relaxed steering rack, and that makes this a little less nervous at high speed, and I suppose that's the kind of experience you want in a Grand Tour like this. Hey, for fun, let's try the brakes, shall we? Wow! Okay. The brakes are incredibly strong, and there's great feel here as well. It is a proper driving experience on the brake pedal alone. You've got a lot of confidence in that brake pedal. I really shouldn't be surprised because, of course, Ferrari has known how to build driver's cars for a long, long time. The other thing about braking is ABS is the only driver aid in this 456. Like I said, no stability, no traction control, it's all on you. Wow. It does brake like a modern car, that's for sure. I do have to talk about the 456's handling, and it's not quite what I was expecting. And then I had to remember that, oh, this car is from 1995. It was developed in the early 90s and was intended to be a Grand Tour. And what I found is that this is a delightfully comfortable car to drive and ride in. Its handling limits do seem pretty high, but the ride is exceptionally comfortable. It does have multi-mode dampers. Can't quite tell what this is doing with the switch because there's no display, but what I do find is there is actually a noticeable difference between damper settings. And this is a car from 1995. That's a different era. We do have a bit of difference in terms of damping and especially rebound. I was originally driving this on soft and there was a little too much movement. Now that I've got it on full hard, apparently body and wheel motion is better controlled. Otherwise, I can't complain about the ride of this 456. It's very, very comfortable. On the other hand, there's a bit more body roll than I did anticipate with this 456. And what that does, doesn't give me a tremendous amount of confidence to push this near its limits. As you know, this is not my car, so I'm not about to do that. And this is a different kind of driving experience. This is really not something you want to take to the racetrack, push around at its limits. This is a true Grand Tour in every sense of the word in terms of its dynamic package. It's very, very comfortable drive, and it makes this an extremely unique driving experience, especially in context of this being nearly a 30-year-old car. Like I mentioned earlier, it doesn't feel like it weighs 3,700 pounds. It feels like it weighs like 3,000 pounds. It's more compact. It feels very light on its feet. It's extremely maneuverable, changes direction so easily. It just is the right size for me, and it's the right size for a modern Grand Tour. If you think about modern Grand Tours, they are much bigger, much heavier, and really at a different scale. This is like a 7-8 scale modern Grand Tour, and for me, this is just the right size. Certainly a beautiful shape, and it definitely feels much lighter on its feet. How do you spec yours, or at least how do you find the right spec in the secondary market? And that is a challenge, because in 1995, this was top of the range and it was about $300,000, and they sold very, very few of these. And there are very few available on the open market today as we're talking. And this is the challenge. It's going to be very hard for you to find one of these in the right condition, in the right colors. As for me, really love the black. Black is perfect on this 456, and I don't mind the red interior. Manual transmission, well, you know, we've got to save the manuals on this channel. As for the value of something like this, it's really hard to say what this one is worth, but this car isn't about what it's worth. Let me tell you a story. And here's the thing about this 456. Some of you know I co-host a radio show called Dave's Corner Garage, and the namesake is Dave Redinger, who I met maybe a dozen years ago. And the first day I met Dave, he was driving this car, and he was extremely proud of it. Here's the thing. He bought this car many, many years ago after it had been involved in a wreck. He bought it for about 25 grand, and he pieced it together, sourced all the parts, and this is the car that we have today. But Dave was extremely proud to have put this back together and find a bargain Ferrari, and we know there are no bargain Ferraris, because once you get involved in the repair and mechanical restoration of a Ferrari, it's just a bottomless pit of expenses. But now this car is lovingly cared for by his family. Driving this car brings me back to the day that I met Dave, and you could tell he was extremely pleased with himself, and I'm so thrilled to be able to drive this today and share it with you guys. My verdict? Well, it's been a dream of mine to drive a 456, and this is the first time I've had the occasion, and it does not disappoint. The 456 comes from a different era. It's just after Enzo Ferrari's passing and just before Luca di Montezemolo took over and modernized the whole company. This is the last Ferrari with a body built by Pininfarina. It's certainly the last one with pop-up headlamps, and ultimately, this is the last great analog Ferrari Grand Tourer. Like I mentioned, before the 456, all Ferraris were built with tubular frames, and that's always been part of their charm. After this 456 and the 550 Maranello and the 575, of course, Ferrari started to get fancy with chassis construction, automated gearboxes, stability, traction control, drive modes, never mind some of their later inelegant designs. And most egregiously, shortly after this, they gave up on the manual gearbox. With each new success of Ferrari, they added layer upon layer of electronics, each of which just gets in the way between the driver and the road. Ultimately, the 456 is properly analog. There's that gorgeous naturally aspirated V12 under the hood, a 6-speed manual gearbox, and the only driver aid is ABS. It's the kind of car that does demand your attention and respect, and when you drive it properly, it returns the favor. It's perfection. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 1995 Ferrari 456 GT with a manual gearbox. Hope you liked this episode, and if you did, well, you're not new to YouTube, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring. So please share this episode with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even vintage Ferraris. Gotta love that. This is just delightful.